Now, before we continue the action with July 16, I have to make a correction. On turn number 4, Freccia's cavalry division was forced to attack Coupigny, and Freccia broke. And whenever a unit breaks, its side loses a morale point and the enemy gains a morale point. We will now make that adjustment to the morale track. Consequently, French morale is 3 and Spanish morale is 5. And these are the morale levels with which we now start July 16. This is the situation at the beginning of July 16th. The Spanish are approaching Bailén, and also Spanish divisions are moving in the direction of Andújar, and the road between Andújar and Bailén is in Spanish zones of control. So now we go to Spanish turn number 6. And this is the morning of July 16, and there's a note, end group moves. None of the sides are burdened anymore by having to move a maximum number of groups equal to the turn that is in play. So that restriction is lifted. Also, because this is the first day turn after the first night turn in the game, each side has an option known as passing or lulling. And each side, if they do not force march any of their units, nor have any battles in their combat phase or the enemy's reaction phase, the side gains a morale point at the end of its turn. If either of these conditions apply, the side has fewer than 6 morale points, or the side does not have more morale points than the enemy. And first, we go to the Spanish random events phase. We draw an event card, and it says, according to plan, no effect, reshuffle the cards. So we immediately reshuffle the cards. And note that this was the Hold Andalusia card. So if it would have been a French random event phase, the French would have lost the opportunity to withdraw from Andalusia. So we reshuffle the deck, and we now proceed to the Spanish movement phase. And now we roll to see if Cruz Morgión enters the game, and the Spanish need a 6. But the roll is a 5. The Spanish see an opportunity here to deal Vedel a hard blow. Spanish spend a morale point to conduct force marching. La Peña force marches, crossing the Guadalquivir and coming up against Vedel from the south. Coupigny is tired. He cannot force march, but he doesn't have to force march to approach Vedel from the northwest. The Spanish also have a surprise for the forces near Bailén. Reding and Valdecaños cross the Guadid River and fall upon Gobert's division. Thus, the Spanish begin the day with attacks to the east and the west of Bailén. There is no French reaction. Now, on to the battles. Coupigny and La Peña between both divisions can muster 6 combat factors against Vedel's 3. So we start with a +3 differential. The Spanish forces are in command, because La Peña is in the same hex with General Castaños. So there is no command penalty. There are no terrain modifications. And now the Spanish must decide if they will commit their reserves. The Spanish decide to commit no reserves. So now the French must decide whether they commit theirs. The present morale situation is Spanish morale 4, French morale 3. So by committing their reserves, the French would be placing their morale level 2 levels away from defeat. The French are in a very delicate situation. Their morale level is low at level 3. So if they commit their reserves, it will go down to level 2. In addition, on a roll of 6 under the present differential column, Vedel will break, and that means that it will not be able to come back into the game until the next knight turn, and if the French are lucky enough to rally that unit. On a 4 or 5, Vedel will rout and will most likely be forced to cross the Romblar River, and that is a hazardous retreat. So the French now will use the option of the Garde Marine, and this is a special marine detachment that Dupont had with his army, and the effect of that detachment is to increase French strength for this combat by 1, so the differential is now reduced to plus 2. In addition, the marker gives elite status to one participating unit. There's only one Vedel, so Vedel will have elite status, which will reduce the effects of any rout result against it, and Vedel will be able to roll on the elite's units in battle with the possibility of increasing his combat strength by 1. But now we have to roll for Coupigny's reliability. We roll one die, and there is no die roll modification. The roll is a 2, so Coupigny attacks with its normal strength of 3. Now, because Vedel is an elite unit for this combat only, we roll on the elite units in battle table. And none of the die roll modifiers apply. So, on a roll of 6, Vedel will provide an additional combat factor for the French in this battle. But the roll is a 5, so Vedel's strength remains at 3. So now we roll 1d6 on the plus 2 differential column. And the roll is a 5. Vedel is routed. And now we have to roll to determine how many hexes Vedel routes. And the roll is also a 5. And Vedel has to retreat in the direction of the French line of communications at La Carolina. So the first hex places Vedel adjacent to the Rumblar River. And now before attempting to cross the Rumblar, we have to roll on the hazardous retreat table. This die roll here is critical. On a 1, 2, or 3, Vedel will break. 4, 5, or 6, Vedel will cross safely across the Rumblar and continue its retreat. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a 6. Vedel crosses safely. So Vedel is able to successfully retreat across the Rumblar River and into and through Bailén. La Peña advances into the vacated hex, and we place fatigue markers and update the one for Coupigny. And because Vedel routed a number of hexes greater than its movement allowance of 2, French morale is reduced by 1, and it is now at level 2. And now to the battle near the Guadix River. We begin with a plus 2 differential. The Spanish have 5 combat factors, the French 3. However, the Spanish units are out of command, so the differential is reduced to plus 1. There are no die roll modifiers for terrain. So now the sides must choose whether they will commit their reserves. The Spanish decide not to commit their reserves because that would increase the differential to plus two, and they want to stay away from that exchange result, which would signify the elimination of Gobert, but also of Reading's division. Now the French, with only two morale points left, must decide whether they will commit their reserves. The French decide not to use their reserves. So now we have to roll for the reliability of Valdecaños' irregular unit. Spanish morale is higher than French morale, so there is no negative die roll modifier for the Spanish. So the only result that will reduce the differential for the Spanish is a 1. So we roll 1d6, and the roll is a 1. So Valdecaños' unreliable status comes into play here. And the Spanish lose one combat factor, and now the differential is 0. And that's the column that will be used to resolve this combat. So we roll 1d6, and the result is that the sides remained engaged in battle. So there is no advance, no retreat, and now we adjust the fatigue markers. And that is the end of the battle and the end of the Spanish combat phase. Now, fatigue markers on Spanish units that are not within enemy zones of control are adjusted by -1. La Peña is fresh and Cupigny is tired. And now we proceed to French turn number 6. French random event phase. And the event is an inability to decide. The French cannot spend morale points this turn to force march, commit reserves, or rally troops. The truth is, they don't have many morale points to spend to begin with. They only have 2. The situation for the French is critical. Their forces here in Andújar are now isolated, and considerable Spanish forces block the road to Bailén. Meanwhile, Gobert's division is entangled with Reading and Valdecaños and will have to attack them in this turn. Vedel's division here is routed, so it can either move in the direction of the line of communications hex or stay put where it is. In addition, Freixa has to worry about the Spanish forces that will be moving next turn to the high ground to the west of Bailén. If the French do not come to Gobert's rescue, Gobert will be attacking at -2. And at -2, there is a 1 in 6 chance of an attacker breaks result. And there is 2 in 6 chances of being routed. Now, if the French units of Freixa and the Cadre come to Gobert's assistance, the cavalry could attack Valdecaños here, while Gobert and the Cadre attack Reading, but it would be a -1 attack because these French units are out of command. A -1 attack, however, gives the French 2 chances in 6 of a defender withdraws, and that would represent a hazardous retreat for Reading, so that would probably force the Spanish to commit their reserves. The French decide to come to Gobert's rescue. Freixa's cavalry division falls upon Valdecaños, while the Cadre moves into the wooded area next to Reading. Thus, there will be 2 battles to fight there. Meanwhile, Barbao and Dupont stay put at Andújar. And now to the battles near the river Guadix. The Cadre and Gobert attack Reading's division, and we start with a combat differential of 0. The French units, however, are out of command, so the differential is now reduced to -1. There are no terrain effects modifiers, and the French would normally now decide whether to commit their reserves, but because of the inability to decide event, the French cannot do so. The Spanish have a morale level of 4, which is 2 greater than the French morale level. They think it over to see if they will spend 1 point to commit their reserves. If the Spanish commit their reserves, this is the table they would use, which offers them a really good chance of routing the French, and with that, a possible loss of morale because of retreats that are longer than their movement allowance. Plus, there's 1 attacker break. So the Spanish will use their morale point, reducing Spanish morale to 3, to commit their reserves. So for the French, the only positive, if we may say, result is a 6. An attacker withdrawal is not bad either. But on a routed result, the game may end here, and definitely on a breaking result for the attacker, this is game over. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a 6. The sides remain engaged. So all units remain where they are, and we now adjust the fatigue markers. And now to the second battle, Freccia attacking Valdecaños. And we start with a combat differential of 0. But again, because Freccia is out of command, the differential is reduced to -1. There are no terrain effects modifiers, and the French cannot commit their reserves. The Spanish, with 3 morale points, will not commit their reserves. They want to have at least 1 point of morale over the French. So now we roll to determine Valdecaños' reliability. So only on a 1 will the Spanish lose 1 strength point. So we roll 1d6. And the result is a 1, and Valdecaños fails once again. And because of Valdecaños' unreliability, the differential will be 0. So now we roll 1d6, and the result is a 3, another engaged result. So they stay right where they are, and we adjust their fatigue levels. And the French are still in the game. It's the end of the French combat phase. We do not lessen now or reduce the fatigue levels for those French units in Spanish zones of control. However, Vedel's routed marker, as well as its ready fatigue marker, are removed. And that is the end of French turn number 6. And now we move to Spanish turn number 7, the midday turn for July 16. We consult a Spanish random event, and again, according to plan, no effect, and the cards have to be reshuffled. Again, the Hold Andalusia card shows up, but on the Spanish random events phase. So we shuffle the cards one more time, and we have a new draw pile. And the Spanish roll again for the possible entry of Cruz Murguion, and a 6 is needed for that. And at last, the Spanish roll a 6, and Cruz Murguion's irregular division enters the game. And Cruz Murguion enters the game through entry area A, which is here. And by special rule, Cruz Murguion has a +1 movement bonus. So his movement allowance for this turn will be 3. With Cruz Murguion's entry, the Spanish face a dilemma now. They have an excellent opportunity with La Peña and Cupigny to march on Andújar, and with Cruz Murguion and Felix Jones, attack the town from all sides. That would have a great chance of having Barbao eliminated through a hazardous retreat, if forced to retreat, and that could probably and the game, because the loss of the depot would also entail a loss of one morale point for the French. However, the Spanish are entangled with three French units near the Guadix River, and Vedel may join that action, but he doesn't have enough movement points to join that action in one turn. So the Spanish must decide whether La Peña and Cupigny go to the rescue of the entangled Spanish units on the Guadix River, or they go for broke to try to win the game with the surrender of Andújar. In any event, the Spanish would not be able to mount the attack on Andújar on this turn, because even with a force march, the Spanish would not be able to deploy La Peña and Cupigny adjacent to Andújar. So whatever the Spanish will try to do to end the game will take two turns, and that gives the French an opportunity to deal the Spanish a blow here at the Guadix River, because the Spanish will be forced to attack two of their units attacking three French units. So what is the Spanish decision in the end? A compromise. Cupigny marches down the road to Andújar, while La Peña marches on to Bailén. And La Peña surmises that his march on Bailén will keep Vedel honest, and Vedel will have to defend Bailén instead of joining the fray that is happening at the Guadix River. Meanwhile, Cruz Murgión enters into the action, but stays within striking distance of Andújar. Dupont is surrounded. Now to the reaction phase, and Freixa's cavalry division has some alternatives here. Freixa could disengage. By doing so, Freixa would, for instance, move here. Valdecaños would have the option of maintaining contact, and if Valdecaños does that, his unit would follow the vacated hex, and we would place this marker that signifies that Valdecaños' combat strength is halved and rounded up, which in his case is no change at all, because it would still be one, but Valdecaños would have no zone of control. So that is one option that Freixa has. The other option for Freixa is to conduct a countercharge, and that would be an attack against one unit, in which case the only unit adjacent to Freixa is Valdecaños, and the attack would be at doubled combat strength for Freixa. That would be at two, so Freixa would start with a plus one, but because Freixa is out of command, that would be reduced to a zero differential attack. The other option for Freixa would be to conduct a cavalry penetration, that is, move from its hex, which is in an enemy zone of control, to an adjacent hex, also in an enemy zone of control. And in this particular case, Valdecaños would still have to attack Freixa. Now, of course, Freixa has the option of not doing anything, and that would force Valdecaños to attack Freixa during the upcoming Spanish combat phase. And that's what Freixa will do. He will stay put, and the two Spanish units will have to attack the three French units. So the Spanish now decide which attack to conduct first, and they will conduct first the attack of Valdecaños against Freixa's cavalry division. And the combat differential starts at zero. But because Valdecaños is out of command, the differential is reduced to minus one. There is no terrain effect modifier, and the Spanish decide not to commit their reserves. After all, their morale level is at three. So the French decide, with a morale level of two, also not to commit their reserves, and the attack will be solved on the minus one differential column. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a six. Defender withdraws. So Freixa withdraws, and we adjust the fatigue levels for both units. Valdecaños has the option of advancing into the vacated hex, but that hex will place him also adjacent to Gobert. So if he does advance, he will probably have to attack Gobert in the next turn, but if he doesn't, he may still have to attack Gobert depending on what happens in the upcoming battle. So Valdecaños advances into the vacated hex. And now to the battle between Redding and Gobert and the French cadre. Spanish have four combat factors as well as the French, so the initial differential is zero. However, the Spanish are out of command, so the differential goes down to minus one. And one of the defending units, the cadre, is in a wooded hex, and that reduces further the differential now to minus two. With a minus two, the prospects of a favorable result for the Spanish practically vanish. So the Spanish that have one more morale point than the French will be forced to commit their reserves, and they spend one morale point, and now their morale is at level two. And now the French decide whether they will commit their reserves, but that would reduce their morale to one, and that is really a dangerous proposition. So the French will not commit their reserves, and the attack will be resolved at the minus one column. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a four, and the forces remain engaged. So for two turns in a row, those three units have remained engaged. Now we adjust the fatigue levels. Both French units are now weary, and Redding is spent. And that's the end of the Spanish combat phase. We cannot reduce the fatigue levels for Spanish units near Bailén because they are all in French zones of control. But Coupigny's tired status is now reduced to ready. Now it's French turn number 7, midday, July 16th. And we begin with the French random event, and this is scorching heat and clouds of dust. If this is a midday afternoon or evening turn, and this is a midday turn, all French units have their movement allowances reduced by one, and they cannot enter enemy zones of control. So this event is significant for the French because the French were expecting Vedel to come to the rescue of the units near the Guadix River by moving here to attack Valdecaños, but because of the scorching heat and clouds of dust, Vedel cannot enter Valdecaños' zone of control. So there's not a lot that the French can do by moving units. Dupont is, with Barbao's division, practically surrounded at Andújar. Vedel cannot join the fray near the river Guadix, but he must prevent Bailén from falling, so he moves into Bailén. That's the end of the French movement phase, and now to the combat phase, and we continue with the battles near the Guadix River. And it's important to note that both sides now have a morale level of two. The French, wishing to break their deadlock around the Guadix River, will now have a change in plans. Freixa, together with Gobert, will attack Valdecaños in the hopes of forcing Valdecaños to rout and have to retreat through the Guadix River and executing a hazardous retreat. Meanwhile, the cadre will make a soak-off attack on Redding. The worst possible scenario for the cadre would be a 1 in 6 chance of breaking, which would reduce French morale to one. So we start with the battle between Gobert, Freixa, and Valdecaños. The initial differential is plus three, but because the French are out of command, the differential is reduced to plus 2. The French with 2 morale points will not commit their reserves. And neither will the Spanish. So the attack will be resolved at plus 2. So we roll 1d6, and the roll is a 6, and Valdecaños is routed. Now a die roll is made to see how many hexes Valdecaños has to retreat. And the roll is a 5. So Valdecaños retreats the first hex, and now he will attempt a hazardous retreat across the Guadix River. And on a 1, 2, or 3, Valdecaños will break. Otherwise, he will cross safely. So we roll 1d6, and the result is a 2. Valdecaños breaks. So Valdecaños breaks while attempting to cross the Guadix. And his division is eliminated because Valdecaños' division is an irregular unit. It does not return via the rally process. It is permanently eliminated. The breaking of Valdecaños reduces Spanish morale to 1 and increases French morale to 3. The victorious cavalry division of Freixa now must roll to see if it executes a controlled advance or not. On a 1 through 3, Freixa has to advance. On a 4 through 6, it has the option to advance. We roll 1d6. The result is a 4, and Freixa maintains control, and Freixa will not advance into the vacated hex. Gobert also will stay put. Now we adjust the fatigue markers for both victorious French units. Freixa is weary and Gobert is spent. And now to the attack by the French cadre. And the status of morale is 3 for the French and 1 for the Spanish. And the cadre has a strength of 1, reading 4, so the battle starts with a minus 2 differential because that is the leftmost column on the combat's results table. The French are also out of command, but that does not affect the column because, again, that is the leftmost column. The French have to decide, however, whether they will spend a morale point to commit their reserves and improve the combat differential. If the French would decide to spend the point, they would have 1 point left, and with an attacker routed result, they have a good chance of having their own cadre retreated more than 2 hexes, and that would be the end of the game. So the French will not spend a morale point, and the Spanish now, they cannot commit their reserves because their morale would go down to 0. So we will roll 1d6 on the minus 2 differential column. And the die roll is a 2, attacker routed. So the cadre is routed, and we have to roll now to determine how many hexes the cadre will retreat. If it is greater than 3, the French will lose a morale point. And the result is a 5. So the cadre is routed, and it retreats 5 hexes in the direction of the line of communications hex of La Carolina. Because the unit retreated more hexes than its movement allowance, French morale drops to 2. Redding has the option to advance, and he advances into the wooded hex. He's still with the Guadix behind his back, but at least now he is in terrain that offers some defensive benefit. The cadre, which is now routed, is also spent, and Redding is still with his spent fatigue status. Now we adjust French fatigue markers for units that are not in zones of control. The French cadre is weary and Freixa is tired. And that is the end of the French combat phase. The first 2 turns of the 16th of July have seen intense combat to the southeast of Bailén. Meanwhile, in Andújar, Dupont is practically surrounded with Barbao's division and the French depot. Now we move on to the Spanish eighth turn, afternoon of July 16. Spanish random event, and the event is atrocities. Here the Spanish roll a die. If the result is greater than their morale level, they gain one morale point. If it is less, they lose one morale point. And if it is equal to Spanish morale level, there is no effect. And Spanish morale is at one, so there are 5 in 6 chances of increasing morale by one, and only one chance of morale being unaffected. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 5, greater than Spanish morale, so Spanish morale is increased now to level 2. The boost in morale comes for the Spanish in the nick of time. Redding is forced to attack Gobert. La Peña will not be able to reach any position that can help Redding's division, so Castaños leaves La Peña's division and circumvents Bailén to reach Redding's division and provide much-needed command support. Meanwhile, La Peña's division approaches Bailén and stops short of the town to avoid attacking Bedel in circumstances favorable to the French. Meanwhile, around Andújar, the Spanish prepare to fall upon the city. Cruz Murgión, Cupigny, and Félix Jones all converge upon Andújar. And this is an all-out attack, although out of command. There are 2 combat situations to resolve. If the French lose the depot at Andújar, by special rule, the French lose 2 morale points, and that would be the end of the game. But first, the attack on Gobert. The Spanish start with a +1 differential. Castaños provides command, so the Spanish suffer no command penalty. And there are no terrain effect modifiers. The Spanish, with a level 2 morale, do not commit reserves. The French now decide whether they commit their reserves, but they only have 2 morale points. If they commit their reserves, morale will go down to 1, and if they are routed and retreat more than their movement allowance, that's the end of the game. So the French do not commit any reserves, and the battle is ready to be resolved. So we roll 1d6, and the roll is a 4. Defender withdraws. So Gobert retreats 1 hex north. Redding has the option of advancing and occupying the vacated hex, but the Spanish decide to stay where they are so that their fatigue level can be reduced during their turn. Note that because of this battle, fatigue levels for both units cannot be increased because the spent status is the highest form of fatigue level. So the fatigue markers remain the same for now. Now to the battle at Andújar. The Spanish have 6 combat factors, the French have 4. So there is a +2 initial differential. The Spanish forces, however, are out of command, so the differential is reduced to +1. And now the Spanish must decide if they will commit their reserves. With a morale level of 2, the Spanish decide not to commit any reserves. And now the French must decide if they commit their reserves. The French realize that on a result of 3 or higher, the game will be over because the depot will be captured. So the French, even though they have a morale level of 2, will commit their reserves. And French morale goes down now to 1. So now the differential is 0. And before we roll the die to resolve the attack, we have to roll for the unreliable status of all Spanish units, Félix Jones, Cupigny, and Cruz Murgión. There are no applicable die roll modifiers, and only on a die roll of 1 will the Spanish strength be reduced by 1. So we will roll on the map, and we'll start rolling first for Cruz Murgion. So we roll 1d6. The roll is a 6, so Cruz Murgion is unaffected. Next we roll for Felix Jones. And Felix Jones rolls a 1, so the Spanish strength is reduced by 1, with the effect of lowering the differential now to minus 1. And now we roll for Cupigny's division. And the roll is a 4, so Cupigny's strength is unaffected. So now we roll one die to resolve this battle. And given the critical importance of this battle, we will film the die roll live. On a result of 5 or 6, the game will be over with a Spanish victory. So here we go. We roll 1d6. And the result is a 5. Defender withdraws. We will assume that Barbao was able to successfully conduct a hazardous retreat through enemy zones of control. The depot, however, cannot retreat, and it is captured as Spanish units enter Andújar. Loss of the depot, the Spanish lose 2 morale points. With only 1 that they lose the game. And the final result is a Spanish decisive victory, the same level of victory that occurred historically. And that is the end of this playthrough. So we saw in this game a very aggressive Spanish play beginning on the morning of July 16. The Spanish were able to split the French forces in two and deal the final blow at Andújar with the appearance of Cruz Murgion behind French lines. The Napoleonic 20s series has definitely evolved, and the 4.0 system is solid. The standard rules weigh in at around 27 pages, including optional rules. And you may say, well, it's not a beginner's game. Well, if you play with the optional rules, it is not. But when it comes to rules, sometimes a couple of more pages will save you a lot of headaches trying to find rules outside of the game in some other sources. So the rule books here are solid. The game components are very nice. The counters are a joy to handle. They are very thick and they are beautiful. So if you're interested in Napoleonic warfare operational games, give this game a try. Don't be fooled by its appearance. It is also a very exciting gaming experience. The low movement rates of the units give the game a feel of almost semi-simultaneous movement. Every hex here counts, and you are acting and reacting to your opponent all of the time. The random events give the game uncertainty and a great amount of replayability. And there's also a lot of die rolling for things such as hazardous retreats, elite and unreliable units. So there are a lot of uncertain outcomes, and the player must learn to adjust to the developments in the battlefield. So I hope that this video has given you an idea of the gameplay and what this game and system has to offer. So this is Stuka Joe signing off for now. Thanks for watching.